From assured success...
Our vaccination program is on track.
The eagle has landed.
We hope by the end of March to have reached some 4 million population.
That means we're on track to complete this vaccination program for Australians by the end of October.
To moving goalposts.
They'll receive their first dose by the end of October.
It will take as long as it takes.
And that's the goal that we've set, is to try and have all Australians have a dose by the end of the year.
To putting on the brakes. Just after Tegan was out spruiking that target last night, the PM trashed all timelines, sharing this message on his preferred platform for breaking bad news.
The government has also not set, nor has any plans to set any new targets for completing first doses. While we would like to see these doses completed before the end of the year, it is not possible to set such targets given the many uncertainties involved.
That is completely unacceptable.
I know that some people don't think there is a sense of urgency because we're doing so well, but things can change very quickly and I don't want to see our citizens left behind.
Rather than set targets that can get knocked about by every to and fro of international supply chains and other disruptions that can occur, we're just getting on with it.
Scott Morrison is completely stuffing up the vaccine rollout.
Under the original targets, 20 million Aussie adults should have been fully vaccinated by October. That then changed to being offered their first dose. Now the plan is to get on with the job.
You can't have a plan without targets, though.
We're just getting on.
And thanks to changed advice on the use of AstraZeneca, we could be waiting a while for a jab.
If we were to keep the 20,000 injections per day, which has been our average since rollout, it would take a couple of years to get to at least 85% of the population.
The PM has secured another 20 million Pfizer doses due to arrive towards the end of the year, which leaves Australia vulnerable for months to come.
The virus might get out of hotel quarantine. You might see cases that lead to lockdowns and state border closures. That's an extra degree of risk for an extra couple of months. Not the end of the world, but a challenge.
But are we up for another challenge?
Well, we're done with climate change without a target, so what's the problem? Professor Catherine Bennett is here to help us make sense of this situation, which I acknowledge is a bit different to that. She joins us now. So, Catherine, the Prime Minister's effectively abandoned the whole idea of a target and a timeline. How significant do you think that is with the vaccine rollout?
Look, it clearly acknowledges not only the uncertainties but also the current change to our strategy. So that's going to take some manoeuvring to actually get our rollout adjusting to those different age groups and the requirements for different vaccines. So, you know, it's a pity. I think the short-term targets are always difficult anyway, and that was probably ambitious in the first place. But it would have still been good to, I think, have that end-of-year insight.
Catherine, it's fair to say that people are pretty disappointed in the vaccine rollout. It's been described as a dog's breakfast. But by removing these targets, how do we hold the government to account?
Look, I think we are still going to get numbers reported, particularly those critical ones around the proportion of people in aged care, those vulnerable communities that are covered. And I think that's really important to see. But there'll be other process indicators as well. You know, having not too long a queue at the larger vaccination centres when they start up, but also, you know, not having no queue, knowing we're getting our communications right and people are coming forward for the jab. So I think that's important too. But also, I think, a bit of healthy competition, looking at how we're doing compared to similar countries, particularly if we look across the ditch. New Zealand's done really well with COVID, but we've got twice as many people covered with vaccine now, or at least having their first jab per capita. So I think healthy competition. Let's stay in front of New Zealand.
Well, the government keeps telling us that taking our time is a good thing because we have time to observe what happens with vaccines elsewhere. But have we actually squandered that amazing head start that we had?
Look, some of that's really has worked for us, as we've learnt from other countries, and we've also seen these incredibly rare adverse events as well. So that's pretty critical. But at the same time, there are some areas, particularly aged care, where we're still struggling and it's not so clear why we haven't quite got up to speed where we need to be with those. So we've probably lost a little bit, but at the same time, we're at the point where we're really starting to scale up now in terms of those mass vaccination centres. So our numbers per day would really start to climb in these next few weeks in a way that, if we've got the vaccine supply, should really see us hitting our stride and really getting ahead.
Well, of course, supply, Catherine, is the issue. I mean, hindsight's a wonderful thing, but should we have hedged our bets way back when we put our eggs into the basket with AstraZeneca and perhaps looked at some of more Pfizer and some of the other vaccines?
Yeah, look, I think, you know, in February we already doubled our Pfizer, which was, now looking back, amazing, you know, foresight. But I also think that we had arrangements in place that allowed us to keep negotiating what sort of supply we needed. So I do think we've had some advantage in having locally produced vaccine, but also having a choice of vaccines. That's been really important. But also our agreements are still open to negotiating for different dosages. So I do think we've got some flexibility there. But also we've got others like Novavax that we have agreements with that are still in phase three trials. So this will continue to evolve over the rest of the year.
Anecdotally, I'm hearing a lot of vaccine hesitancy. Is that a danger?
It's always a danger. We've been worried about that, you know, before we even got to the rollout stage. Some of that was really focused in our younger adults, particularly females. So hopefully these extra safety steps being taken around the preferred choice for Pfizer for younger adults will resolve some of that too. So hopefully as the year goes on, we won't see that playing out in a big way, and we will get good vaccine uptake. But that's also why it's important to allow people to go to their GPs. So that's a slower rollout strategy, but it's one that I think can really allow people to ask their own questions of their own doctor, and that's going to be really important in hesitancy as well.
Catherine, it's also worth pointing out that AstraZeneca is a really good vaccine, isn't it?
Yeah, look, absolutely. And particularly we're learning more about, in the real world, how it's operating against those the variants we worry about, the variants of concern. And, of course, B117, that's the variant that's been a real problem for us. We've had four situations in Australia now where a virus has crossed over from hotel quarantine to the community, and in all four cases it was the B117. So it's the one we really are worried about. It's also now being associated with higher mortality and morbidity overseas. It's a dominant strain this week in the US, they're now reporting. So AstraZeneca, very very effective against B117 as well. So that's really good to know, because that's what we've got to worry about.
Well, Catherine, always good to get your perspective. Thank you.
Thank you.
Really important today, the Gladys Berejiklian comments, the New South Wales Premier, where she said, OK, we're having this debate, the rollout hasn't been perfect. If we don't fix it, we're going to get left behind. I mean, she wants to set up these big centres using a place at Homebush as one of them to vaccinate a lot of people in a hurry. What she means by that, I presume, is international students coming back, Australian businesses being able to travel, and being able to make plans in your budget if you are a business, knowing you're not going to have state border lockdown somewhere down the track. Mm. So I think Gladys Berejiklian, again, is on top of this, and federal government in Canberra needs to listen.
She's really nailed it all the way along, hasn't she?
She's been great.
Yeah.
Well, really, that depends who you listen to, though, right?
Oh, well,
I don't think Anastasia Palaszczuk...
You're not listening to me, Willie, is that what you're saying?
No, no. Well, this went badly. We're off to a break. We'll see you very soon. From expert opinions to in-depth analysis and reporting, the Project YouTube brings you the biggest stories from Australia and around the globe. Hit the subscribe button now for news delivered straight to your feed.